So for today, for the final day of this boot camp, I have a very difficult task of triaging. You've made immense progress, faster than I was anticipating, more stalwart than I was anticipating, in terms of the material that we've covered. I'm very impressed, very impressed. I have a hard time thinking about any boot camp that I've run where people have absorbed the material so thoroughly and been so focused on following the example. So you'd be congratulated. But even so, we have a very limited time today for what could cover a broad set of materials. And so I think, first of all, I'm going to have to triage, and I'm going to have to cover material that I think could be most fruitful based on discussions with you. And then for the afternoon, we will, first of all, there'll be some project meetings over lunch where we talk about projects. And then for the afternoon, we will be taking suggestions for topics to cover that go beyond what we've been able to hit this morning and the previous week. Okay? So I actually created, because of the enormity of the task that lies before us, I actually created a list of material that I'd ideally like to cover today. And there's a few things that I want to be sure to hit based on feedback thus far. One of the things has to do with choice of different sort of modeling. So our research group at the U of S has many lines of work, and complex systems modeling or system science modeling, the sort of modeling we're talking about this boot camp, is probably responsible for the plurality of our work, but not the majority even. I spend a huge amount of time these days doing biostatistical modeling, recurrent events analysis, competing risks, survival analysis, in large part to parameterize these models, actually, to derive parameters that can go into the models, but also for other purposes. I also spend a lot of time doing machine learning, classification, and inferencing with statistical models there as well, more computationally driven statistical models. I further spend a lot of time on creating systems for primary data collection, which are powerful and up to the task, and some software engineering as well. But one of the questions which has come out at a couple times in this boot camp is when does one use complex systems modeling techniques versus, say, traditional statistical techniques, or for that matter, machine learning techniques. And I'd like to use this slide because I think it's one that probably many people in this room will be familiar with already at its high level. But it's just worth reflecting on features of systems that point us to a need for complex systems methods, for system science methods. And I've listed many of them here, and indeed many of these have been points of some discussion during the bootcamp. The presence of feedbacks and reciprocal causality, where we don't have a neat situation where, you know, A causes B and B causes C and D, D and E cause F, but where instead we have reciprocal causality where, you know, one thing causes another and there's an effect back. So it may be, for example, that Hep C infection worsens the progression of HIV, and the presence of HIV further motivates the use of drugs which are hepatotoxic and therefore can worsen the progression of Hep C. So you have this interaction there between common co-infections. Alternatively, it may be reciprocal causality involving people's situation, so between poverty, inability to travel to get a job, and therefore worsening the cycle of poverty. So it may be involving interaction effects with an environment.
So when we have reciprocal causality, a lot of the techniques we use, even more sophisticated techniques like path analysis, we have trouble grappling with this reciprocal causality, and often often make assumptions either involving linearity or involving directed structure of a graph, which raise problems if we want to understand these systems with feedbacks and causality in them. Another feature is path dependence. We had some discussion of that yesterday over lunch that I wasn't directly part of, but I certainly heard a lot. You know, how early life insults or early life exposures can shape the life course in some notable ways. So things that occur in utero or during the birth process may set someone off in a different trajectory. And we know since the work of Barker in the UK, looking at the effects of deprivation in early life, that you know, early life experiences, even when controlling for later life opportunities, those early life experiences can cast long shadows on the life course. And there's a lot of talk these days from Neil Helfen and George Kaplan and others about the need for life course perspectives. Sandra Galea has written eloquently about this. And this is an aspect of path dependence. We know that systems where you have this dependence on history, where an early exposure can shape the trajectory from then on, it's very hard to model those in a really thoroughgoing fashion with traditional tools. And the best tools that we have are tools of dynamic modeling that can allow us to characterize that dependence. The effects of localized environment on localized perception on decision making, for example, often associated with this individual decision making, often motivates the use of these models. We can have statistical models of travel behavior, for example, but if you want to understand why people are slowing down around a curve because of limited visibility or people's psychological reactions to traffic in terms of finding other routes, that requires a mechanistic model, a model where you actually simulate an individual, their particular range of visibility, and the decision-making accordingly. So the effects of a localized environment and its impact on their decision-making based on that context. Sometimes we have, and this is quite common, I think, in a health and veterinary science context, different effects at different scales. So we might have certain effects that occur immunologically within an individual. We have effects which occur in that individual and their interactions with those in the particular environment, and then the effects which might occur across a farm and across a region. And these are different effects. They are effects that have very different characteristics at those different levels. And if we wish to tease out some aspects of these effects, there are tools in statistics, very powerful tools, multi-level modeling, random effects methods, which can allow us to do this. And you know, I've been privileged to be part of teams which have made use of those tools to good effects. But if we want to understand why we see these effects, these emergence of different patterns at different levels, in the human context, you know, the level of an individual and the family and the level of a school and the neighborhood, etc., to really explain those well, to explicate them and understand where they come from and how interventions would change them, counterfactual interventions, really we need to deal with a dynamic model, particularly when they're entangled. Upper level processes affect the lower level, etc. Sometimes we're dealing with network effects, effects where a person's network position, the fact that they have a large number of people around them, has a disproportionate impact on the outcomes of the system. We know this for STIs is a big effect, right? So you think about gonorrhea and chlamydia. Since the work of York back in the 1980s, together with his co-author, we know that there's been big effects associated with core groups. So an individual having more network connections means they're simultaneously more likely to get infected in the first place and more likely to pass it on to a large number of people. And as a result, you get this kind of tail wagging the dog situation where a small, small subset of the population, maybe 5%, which has adverse risk behaviors, ends up shaping the epidemiology for the large population. It keeps the disease alive, even though R naught computed at a population level would suggest that it goes extinct. If you consider the network effects, you find that just averaging over the network, dealing with the nice constructs of aggregate mathematical epidemiology, computing the average contact rate and the average basic reproductive number, you're fooling yourself. It's really about the networks. And networks serve as very important mediating channels for knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs, for pathogen, for risk perception, et cetera. And sometimes they're quite central to our investigations. In the context of veterinary science, networks between producers may also be of significant interest. So the relationships between a facility with on a pig farm and perhaps the farrowing sites associated with it or what have you. The presence of heterogeneity often goes along with this. The fact that some people are different is not just merely all come out in the wash in terms of an average, but it ends up affecting things in a big way. And often, you know, when we're dealing with complex systems, our interests are in dynamics. Disequilibrium behavior. It's not that we just want to find some disequilibrium. We care how we get there. How soon will an intervention have its effects? If we're a policymaker, if we're trying to advise a policymaker, we need to be able to say something about how soon these benefits will be seen. Otherwise, we might write off a policy that's actually very successful or will be successful as a dud and discontinue it before it has genuine time to show its effects. A big problem out there, because sometimes people have, you know, misjudged just how soon they should see a gain from an intervention and thereby write it off without really giving it a due chance. This is often associated with some aspect of delays. When we have adaptation and learning, when the actors in our system, be they producers applying antibiotics or be they practicing veterinary services, if you have adaptation and learning going on, capturing that adequately is very difficult to do with a traditional technique. And we can articulate a model which does capture elements of learning and adaptive behavior within a dynamic context. Sometimes we have nonlinearities which apply. In infectious disease, of course, this is classic. We'll have tipping points where if we can get that level of herd immunity that's going to be effective, the infection will entirely die out. Or we may have nonlinearities in the sense that, you know, doubling the size of an intervention does far more than just double the size of the effect. And finally, interagent effects, sometimes through networks, sometimes through as governed by mobility or contact patterns associated with mobility rather than fixed networks, are often of centralist in a complex systems context. So if you're dealing with a system which exhibits these characteristics, there's a case to be made that complex systems methods may be an important tool in your toolbox to address needs here. But then there's the questions about the research needs that you have at hand. I argued that first day that models are like maps. They are specific to your needs. Which map you use will be specific to your needs. You use a very different map to figure out why flooding's occurring in Minneapolis than you will to drive across the city, and so it is with models. You have very different models. And whether you even need a dynamic model will depend on the questions you are trying to ask. And there are questions that you will ask of complex systems that sometimes don't need a full bang-on dynamic model. There may be questions which are very amenable to traditional statistical techniques in terms of trying to understand the coefficients associated with certain covariates in relationships that are quite small scale and therefore aren't exhibiting, for example, feedbacks within them. And so we might use a survival analysis to understand how certain characteristics of an individual, for example, predispose them to become exposed to so how they impact the likelihood that they will be infected given exposure to TB, for example. So we might use a competing risks analysis to look at an individual who's at risk of dying and at the same time of exposure over time. And in those cases, you might not need a dynamic model. But on the other hand, if you want to understand how an intervention, a counterfactual intervention, will affect the prevalence of TB or the incidence of TB within a community, you'll need a complex systems model. So there are questions at a finer grained scale that are often amenable to traditional techniques, even within complex systems. But within the complex systems, often to understand the emergent behavior and particularly how novel interventions will affect that behavior, we're in the area where system science methods are required, are really needed. As a general rule, statistical techniques, and I have a slide deck that I've given to you on this, statistical techniques secure much of their power, and it's great power, by dealing with observables and sometimes positing a certain amount of latent structure that might explain those observables that we see. Statistical methods come in a wide variety of varieties, but we're typically dealing with empirical observations by the nature of statistical models. By contrast, in dynamic models, while we build them with reference to empirically observed patterns, and while we will calibrate them and raise confidence about them by reference to those patterns, by raising conviction the model actually reproduces the observed patterns for the historical period, much of their goal is to examine counterfactual situations, situations which have never been observed before, and therefore where there is no empirical data to observe, to calculate, to infer from directly. And what that means almost invariably, and this is a key point, is that when we are thinking about counterfactual observations, we typically change the nature of the data generating process on which statistical models rely. So a statistical model, be it a sophisticated recurrent events analysis or a simple hypothesis test using more traditional methods, those techniques will rely on certain associations that are empirically observed. Those associations are based on some underlying data generating process. And one of the problems with using statistical techniques for overall behavior, and note my qualifier there, overall behavior of complex systems, is that the nature of those patterns that are seen, the nature of the associations, will be rather different in a situation where we have a counterfactual intervention in place. So if we start with a model that is simulating out over time, the burden of illness in a given community, and we look at the associations between socioeconomic status and education levels and burden of illness, we may find one thing. But if we put in place an intervention, particularly one that's new, we may see a very different association betweenst those because we've intervened upon the situation. And we can't rely on those associations, which have been measured empirically to this point, necessarily carrying over to this new context because it's a new data generating process. And it's in that area that system science models, the dynamic models, shine, because they are designed to try to posit certain patterns of causality which are going to be driving the system mechanistically and are therefore going to apply just as much in the counterfactual context as in the observed context. So a dynamic model One of its foremost goals is to examine novel strategies that have never been examined before, be they surveillance strategies, screening strategies, strategies for data collection, strategies associated with intervention. That, I think, is perhaps one of their, well, it's their foremost sort of use. And if you're dealing with a situation where you're analyzing observables, you might use a dynamic model, but you might be able to make use of statistical models as well, traditional statistical models or machine learning statistical models. So broadly speaking, those are some comments on the relationship between complex systems and statistical models. And you will find within the elements that I've given to you, there's dynamic and statistical models where you will find additional comments by me on the relationship between these and commenting on this whole issue of the fact that we're dealing with associations from a data generating process with statistical models, and we're dealing with a different sort of beast with dynamic models. And the risk is, if we're trying to understand the effects of interventions that are changing the system in a substantive way, and we rely on statistical models, it's like driving looking out the back window of the car. We're trying to make our decisions based on what's been observed in the past, but what's in front of us may be very different, and we may end up in a world of hurt. So dynamic and statistical models are incredibly complementary. You can't build a dynamic model without some recourse, or a really empirically grounded one, without some recourse to good statistical models. And much of my time professionally is spent doing statistical modeling for our dynamic models. But they each have their own domains. But the other mistake is, you don't want to build a dynamic model where a statistical model will do just fine and can satisfy the needs. So be aware of that interplay. If there are particular research questions that you have where you're not sure which is needed, I'd be glad to talk about them. Anyone want to raise any right now and I could comment on them? No?
Just another comment about, like, what do you think about structural equation modeling or path analysis?
Sure. So I actually have some comments in there on path analysis and structural equation modeling. Great techniques, and we do quite a bit with that and similar techniques. I would say that they have a lot of advantages over a classic multivariate regression, you know, where you're treating all the covariates as kind of on the same level. They do have, however, certain limitations. And you know, path analysis, you know, I'd be interested in dialoguing about their ability to take into account reciprocal causality. I think this might be a significant issue, but I need to think more about it. But, you know, there is an assumption in path analysis that a given variable has, for path analysis specifically, that it has associated observations with it. And the insistence on absence of reciprocal causality, for many complex systems, this is a challenge. And then, you know, the assumptions of linearity and Gaussian error terms can sometimes be a problem, particularly in the context of epidemiological processes where you have small numbers. And so the processes, the error terms are not Gaussian because you can't have less than zero observations, for example. But having said this, for me, I wish I had a slide which really nailed this, but one of the observations here is we often use statistical models using path analysis or SEM or directed Bayesian models, that class of things, and using, you know, recurrent events analysis, competing risks, survival analysis. We'll often use that on smaller bits of the system. By that, I mean relationships within the system between covariates and outcomes that are then incorporated into the larger system, which is simulated in a dynamic model. So again, it might be something like, how does my risk of infection with TB given exposure depend on my housing? How does it depend on my immunological status? think about for individuals who are HIV infected or on dialysis or have diabetes or are smoking and therefore adversely impacting their immune system. How do those factors affect it? So how is it affected by crowding or ventilation in the home? How is it affected by the social context? So whether I'm in, for example, a home where I have long periods of exposure throughout the day or shorter periods. So there might be a statistical model that's used for that relationship to very good effect. Another one would be, how does my age and time with diabetes affect my likelihood of developing end-stage renal disease over time? So I might do a competing risk analysis where the two competing risk events are end-stage renal disease and death. And I could derive that relationship, and then I could put it into a dynamic model to take into account the more full system. So the way I think about it is, and I could be faulted for this, because you know we're all finding our way in this complex landscape with these different techniques. But the way I think about it is, often the dynamic model is needed to account for the emergent patterns you see coming out of the interactions of all these lower level factors. But those interactions themselves, of those factors, that you know, point by point interactions of A with B and C, with housing, with risk of infection, and together with behavioral risk factors like smoking and that, those might be characterized statistically, but to see the overall effects on burden of illness, I'd use an agent-based model or a system dynamics model. Often an agent-based because it allows for articulation of the patterns of an individual's risk behavior on their outcomes, et cetera. So our aggregate models will often include many statistical relationships that have been derived through statistical analysis as sub-pieces. But then the dynamic models are calculating the reciprocal causality. They're capturing the effects of environment. They're capturing the effects of decision making. Now, the impact of making a given decision on risk might be calculated statistically, but the dynamic model is calculating the decisions over time an individual is making, how their choice set varies by the environment they're in, their mobility patterns, and capturing their progression among health states based on infection, etc. It's just that many of the relationships captured in that model have been derived statistically. So I think of it as kind of statistical models often directly feeding in relationships and data parameter estimates into dynamic models, which then use those, extrapolate them, and link them into emergent behavior. That's how I think they will often come together. It's not the only relationship. We're doing a tremendous amount these days with combining statistical techniques like MCMC and particle filtering, sequential Monte Carlo methods, on the one hand, with dynamic models also. And there, they don't work so much, as one colleague of mine puts it, she had this very nice distinction, in a serial way, one feeds the other. They work in parallel. So you have dynamic models on the one hand, and statistical models working together at the same time to give an answer. And MCMC can be used to sample from parameter values and from outcomes associated with the dynamic model, and particle filter to bring that dynamic model together with new data as it comes in to help it learn from empirical observations and help it project forward with greater accuracy going forward. So it's kind of a way of keeping it live, doing dynamic recalibration in a certain sense of that model, in a rough sense. So statistical models, though, while we are doing those things, those are somewhat more advanced. For the most part, I see statistical models as contributing parameter values and relationships to our dynamic models. Is that helpful?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So I see those working together. It's not one or the other, it's both. But the dynamic model is kind of the overarching structure that often incorporates these parameter values that have been estimated with statistical methods, or these relationships between covariates in the dynamic model which shape agent evolution. Yes?
So for particle filtering,
yeah.
Is that something AnyLogic currently does, or is that under development? And would you picture applying particle filtering to agent-based modeling at the end of one run so you can solely update your parameter values, or do you do it dynamically during the run?
That's a great question. So
somebody has experience with particle filters.
Yeah. So I have on this computer, I have something like 4 particle filter models created in AnyLogic, if you're interested in looking at them. They are, without wanting to take this in a different, to monopolize the entire morning with it, I'd be glad to show you, just to give you a sense of this. What I could do is to quickly call up a presentation that I've given on this subject, pardon me for so what we need to do is go to so I'm just gonna get a presentation I gave in the past few months on this. Right. Here we go. Actually, this would be in conferences. Here we go. This will do. Basic idea here. We're dealing with outbreak responses, and the idea is often we'll build a rough and ready model, particularly for emerging infectious diseases where we don't have good data. Our parameter estimates and even our sense of the natural history of infection is still emerging, and we're not sure what we're dealing with. If we take the time to wait until the best estimates are in for that, we may have missed the immediacy if we need to inform policy decisions. A second reflection is even the most detailed model. You can have a superbly detailed model of a given situation that you've built with agent-based modeling in the most detailed fashion possible, and it's going to eventually diverge from the external world if you run it forward because of the vagaries of stochastics, a lot of uncertainties about things. Things will change in the world that aren't in a way that's not reflected in the model. So our vision here was to build quickly formulated, frequently regrounded models. And for a couple reasons, calibration won't do it. So we're dealing here with, in contrast to traditional Kalman filtering, particle filtering. And the idea here is to be able to sample from a distribution that incorporates some fallible model predictions with noisy data that's coming in, data that we know is also problematic, and to use that to sample over distributions for possible values. And I show here an example where we have an extremely inaccurate model, and I deliberately chose this, to have a model that's way off in terms of its estimates. And new data comes in, and I have to apologize, but basically these bars indicate, at the end of a bar here, data comes in. And you'll see this thing is going off and coming to best guesses as to how the outbreak will evolve that are very far off. And then new data comes in, it regrounds it. New data comes in, it grounds it. And you see it bringing this model back to Earth every time, bringing it back and potentially updating its estimates of parameter values as well. So, without going into it basically in any detail, particle filtering is basically having a survival of the fittest for different hypotheses for what's going on in the world. And you represent a set of samples from a distribution. It's based on something called important sampling, based on a particle. We did this work with a system dynamics model, an aggregate model, such as you might build really quickly to address an emerging outbreak with a type of pathogen whose parameters might not be fully pinned down. So it's acceptable, exposed, recovered in a vaccinated state. And basically what we do here is we capture over time, as new data comes in, we're going to update the model sense of what's going on in the world. Between observations, this model just runs out. And when new data comes in, it updates based on the observation according to a posterior distribution. So there's a likelihood function that specifies for a given particle, what's the likelihood of observing this new empirical data? A particle is kind of representing a hypothesis for what's going on out there in the world in terms of parameter values. And some of those hypotheses might be more consistent with, might be more better matched to the empirical data that's noted. Others are going to be far off. And the likelihood function is going to capture the likelihood of observing the empirically observed datum given your hypothesis about the world in terms of parameter values. And critically, to evaluate that likelihood function, you're going to need to have run this to run this model. So when a new data point comes in, we have these weights associated with each particle that it's weights from important sampling that represent sort of how well that particle has matched the empirical data. And when a new data point comes in, those weights are updated by virtue of the evaluating the likelihood function. And in this case, we're using something called a condensation algorithm, where we just multiply it by the likelihood function. We use likelihood functions of a certain sort. But the basic idea here, if we drill down here, is we have this model, and the model has empirical data to a given point that's been observed. And it's trying to predict forward from this point. It's trying to predict what's going to happen. And naturally, it's going to grow more and more uncertain about what's happening in the future than it has been about what's obtained to this point. So this is the area for which it's had data, and this is what it thinks. The blue is what it thinks the underlying situation was. The red is the actual datum received. And here, as we move forward, there's a broad uncertainties. These points have not yet been observed. There's actually one up here. And as new data comes in, it's basically updating its estimate of parameter values and updating its estimate of what's the underlying situation in terms of the number of people in the SEIR and vaccinated compartments. And here, as each new data point comes in, we're putting in place this update, and then we're projecting out going forward what we expect to happen, taking into account the knowledge from all those data points thus far to constrain our what otherwise would be very broad guesses as to what's happening. So basically, all these data points have shaped to constrain our parameter estimates and shape to constrain our estimates for what's going on in the world. And as a result, as time goes on, the model gets better and better able to predict going forward what's likely to happen. And this is all occurring in an automated fashion. And it turns out that by using a particle filter, you can get much, much better results than from traditional just calibrating a model to data to this point. This is a log axis here. This is a log axis. So you know, this difference in numbers is, it needs to be taken into account that we're off by orders of magnitude. So this is the results with discrepancy from the empirical data. If you simply calibrated the model to this certain point based on the data and then projected forward versus if used a particle filter. The particle filter, in calibration, what we're doing is we're adjusting our estimates of the best parameter values, static parameter values, and particle filtering, we're actually adjusting our estimates of the current situation as it exists out there. How many people are susceptible, infected, exposed, recovered in the world out there? Something we can't observe directly, but we get some hints of it from the actual observed data. And second of all, it's updating its estimates of parameter values over time. So we can have some number of people that are judged to be affected, or their contact rate over time could be evolving as this outbreak takes place. And so we can capture that with the particle filtering. As a result, it can have far, far better results than traditional, than you can get with traditional calibration. So this is an example of a statistical method, particle filtering, being used together with a dynamic model. Now, in any logic, this is pretty straightforward today. And we have several models which we could share where we do it. We've done it for TB, we've done it for H1N1, we've done it for a model where we actually have synthetically generated the data from a complex, or a somewhat complex agent-based model, one with network structure, et cetera, and we compare it to what we would think is going on with particle filtering and compare it with that underlying ground truth. We've also done it more recently for, there's another bug I think we're doing it for that I'm drawing a blank on. Kurt has done it with ABM as well. And that's a much more involved process, the particle filtering. So doing it with an aggregate model, a model even if it's stratified in any logic is pretty straightforward. Doing it with an agent-based model involves considerably more mechanism. Kurt did it in any logic, but it involved basically a lot of mechanism to simulate the agent-based model there. Yeah. So right now we're not aware of any frameworks that support this automatically, but we've been working on any logic to incorporate it as a regular part of their tool.
So I have data that's like a snapshot data rather than like
longitudinal
adding data over time.
Yeah.
So I was considering particle filtering, but most of the tutorials I've read on it are more like having this, what you just described.
Yeah.
So first, can I use it? And second, my understanding is this takes a very, very large number of simulations. And, you know, we've been using, to do large number of simulations, we've been using a supercomputer. And I'm just wondering about the computational intensity to do particle filtering through any logic.
Yeah, great question. With an SEIR model, such as we used here, we're running this. So right now, back at the mothership, we are running this with large-scale H1N1 exploration. We are running it with 10,000 particles, and each simulation takes about 15 minutes. When I say each simulation, I mean with 10,000 particles, covering those 10,000 in any logic. So it's actually not horrible. But mind you, that's with an underlying SEIR model, which is a very lightweight model. By contrast, Kurt's model with an agent-based underlying simulation, I think it was significantly slower, was it not?
Mm-hmm.
So do you remember any statistics on that?
I mean, we only had maybe 1,000 particles rather than 10,000.
Yeah.
Just because each particle, a compartmental SEIR model is just a sort of three equations that you're kind of tracking over time. But in our case, the particles were agent-based models themselves. So I know when we were running, let's say, 30 full simulations on this laptop, which isn't a supercomputer, but it's a pretty fast laptop, took the whole evening. 4 or 5 hours or something. So, if you're running on a supercomputer, it's one advantage of it is that it's imminently parallelizable.
Yeah.
So, I mean, each particle runs kind of separately, and then every time period you kind of do your particle update. So, if you have access to a supercomputer, I wouldn't say that that's necessarily the biggest weight. Again, depending on the complexity of your underlying model. But if you're only calibrating it to one snapshot of your data, then maybe more additional techniques of calibration would be a little bit more appropriate in that context.
Possibly, yeah. Because normally particle filtering, where sequential Monte Carlo methods really really come to their own is when you have data coming in over time, because you can again, forgive me for those who are totally new to this, but basically you update your weights on the particles from the earlier update. Each time new data comes in, you're updating those weights, right? And so it's really, you save a lot of effort by virtue of this recursive structure where you're just updating weights from the previous time as new data comes in, rather than computing it de novo. If you just have one set of data, if you're dealing with a deterministic model, then I would use MCMC, is what I would do to sample from parameter values. And we have published work on that, and we have a version of that for any logic, doing MCMC sampling. So you can sample from parameter values, and that allows you to sample from output trajectories of the model, or gain sample from distributions of gains from this intervention compared to that one quite effectively. But it's something where, again, you want to use it with deterministic models. By contrast, particle filtering can be used very well with agent-based models if you have that. We make a lot of use of farms of computers, clusters, and mapping it out for clusters for certain types of models that we do. We haven't had to make big use of this for particle filtering yet, although we're just on the edge of doing that when we're systematically exploring the space with particle filtering, the impact of certain parameters for particle filtering on the outcomes. But hope those are helpful comments. Yeah,
mostly.
I could talk more about those. I mean, it might be, it's a fairly specialized topic that Kurt and I are, it so happens both of us in this room are quite familiar with it. And possibly we could talk about it later today, or, you know, worst case, at the end of the day, or over a phone call or something. But it's an area of very active development, and I'd be glad to share models that show in very mechanistic terms exactly how we do this. There's no rocket science there. It's just very straightforward sort of application of the ideas of particle filtering in any logic. And it turns out any logic, by virtue of its being written in Java and being very extensible, you can do this without a lot of mechanism. And in fact, my student, Priyasri Bhoumik, for her master's thesis, she actually has a very nice MCMC adaptation of any logic, where you can basically run MCMC on a model of your choosing with very little adaptation of that model. You provide a couple of functions to compute the posterior, the likely, or the prior, and you can run it on it, pick which parameters to do. It will actually sample from it over time. You can assess convergence in a window that it calls up, et cetera. It's quite nice.
All right, yeah, I'd love to talk more about it. Take too much time, people may not be interested, so.
Sure, okay, this sounds good. And your name?
Kim,
okay, thanks. Anyway, those are some comments on statistical models and dynamic models. What I will say is that it's my own belief that you will sometimes see dynamic modelers as disparage or otherwise cast aspersions on statistical models. And I believe that's entirely inappropriate. I think both are incredibly valuable tools of the toolbox. And from my perspective, you can't build a highly grounded empirical dynamic model without statistical model. And I believe they're complementary. And per Kim's question, I believe actually going forward, you know, if we run for 25 years, I think we're going to see a lot of these cherished prejudices and clear divisions between what's dynamic modeling and what's statistical modeling blurring some. And in fact, per Nick's question with path analysis and in general what I take what are sometimes called causal statistical models, I think we're actually getting a situation where some statistical models become more mechanistic and where statistical models start to incorporate some of the characteristics we've long thought purely the purview of dynamic models. And conversely, we're going to see dynamic models going a lot further because they are combined artfully with elements of machine learning and computational statistics. And this is a lot of what our research program is about, and and indeed Kurt's thesis, for example, combining aspects of machine learning and dynamic modeling. And really, I think that's where there's big opportunities. And so I caution against any people who think, you know, you can stay in purely one domain and know nothing about the other. It'll be a big mistake. You need both. You need both wings of that bird. And more than that, I think, you know, in the next 5 or so years, some of the most cutting edge stuff is combining the two already. Some of our work, but some of the work in mathematical epidemiology, they're making use of models that incorporate mathematical epidemiology findings using genomic results together with results from dynamic models that might simulate pathogen evolution together in, you know, one model to do more effective dynamic modeling and looking forward at the effects of an intervention or what have you. And I really think that's where the cutting edge is at now. I remember time was maybe 8 years ago, maybe it was closer to seven, I was at a workshop of dynamic modeling, and I remember there were dynamic modelers there, you know, actually of foremost prominence, who had no idea of statistical modeling, and you know, they had never heard of multi-level statistical models, and were quite unaware of what was going on statistically. And I think that age is coming to an end. I think dynamic modelers need to be immersed in statistical models as well, and there needs to be that dialogue between the two. And it's my hope that those communities will be interacting very tightly. It's a big difference from when I started health modeling 15 to 20 years ago, when we just didn't know how to talk with each other. Now I think the communities need to blend much more fully, and there's all sorts of opportunities at that interface. Okay, comments? Any questions? Okay, so maybe what I will do here, can we have a break for a few minutes? And then we'll pick up with some other elements of talking about making use of models. And we're gonna talk some about trade-offs between these dynamic modeling methodologies, aggregate, agent-based, discrete event modeling, and talk some about that cacophony, because there's cherished prejudices there as well, and there's real trade-offs. And I'm trying to convey in a very brief way my understanding of where those trade-offs lie and how we can work multiple methods most effectively. Okay? So come back in just a few minutes here.
I love the like system dynamics slash like line rights based on the lower the subtypes. Like extend that, that's the kind of extension I think can work in any one of the space. Yeah, you know, because you